Good morning. How is everyone today? All right, let's see. Does anyone have a memorable photograph of which you can probably tell a story or write a book about? See, a lot of hands. So it's probably good to say or safe to say that a photo is worth a thousand. So here are the basics of a digital camera. I use right now a Canon G9. It's still considered a point and shoot, but it's on the higher end, and a point and shoot means they actually do the focusing for you. You really don't have as much control as, say, an SLR, which you're able to focus more manually and have control over the different functions and settings. So here you have a general internal flash, viewfinder, lens, and so forth. Once you get on top, I would probably say the settings and the mode is probably the most confusing for some users if you're not too familiar with the digital camera. But what that basically does, it sets up different, the manufacturer has already set up different exposures for you for how a photo would come out looking. For example, they have beach mode, fireworks setting, foliage. And what that basically is they set the aperture, which is the amount of light that is allowed in, which is represented by, it's called f-stops, and then the shutter speed of how long you want that light to come in. So what I do is I like to just play around and see what works, and now that it's digital, you can have the images for as long as you want. You don't have to worry about processing film, and you could see, you know, what looks, what you like, and what looks good. iOS speed control, I'm still learning about that, because with digital you're not actually using film, you're actually using a sensor, so the speed has to do with the sensitivity of the film, so I'm not sure exactly how that's used, but it's on there in any case, and we'll figure it out someday. And you got the zoom, the shutter button, and the zoom control to go closer, farther away. General stuff that you'll find in any kind of digital camera, but every camera is a little bit different in where it's located. The back. Again, probably the function setting dial where you can set how you want the camera to look, if you want it to make sounds, if you want to... Alright, so in the article they explain how the use of other popular technology like the computer is a great way to get kids involved in technology and get them used to what, you know, today's generation is using for information and stuff like that. But what they also said, sometimes it becomes more teacher-centered, where the teacher's actually using the computer and the students are just watching her or him, or, you know, it's on a big projector and they're not actually actively. The digital camera, however, they have argued that it transcends these limitations because, one, it's very portable. It can be brought anywhere in the classroom, basically, or anywhere outside the classroom. You know, you can hold it in your hand, put it around your neck. It's not very... annoying. It doesn't cause much problems of, you know, bringing it around. It stimulates inquiry, and especially in science learning, it's all about inquiry. The how, the what you want to know, it's a process. So just the functions alone of the camera, a student can spend a whole day or 2 days or however long exploring that and seeing, well, if this photo takes it like this, and if I change this setting, how will it look different? So it's very involved. It helps stimulate thinking and inquiry. And it engages the students in roles and participation. They're the photographer, they're taking shots of the participant, and vice versa. And it gets them very, again, involved and intrigued by what a camera can capture in still life. Learn and share through visuals. This is very important, actually, for students with disabilities. If they're not good at writing or speaking, they can do it with a camera. They can capture their view, and the teacher, either on a whole group basis or individually, can explore with them what they saw, what they've learned from that one photo or from the process of working with the camera. And to generally cover, you know, go generalize that, it's both science and art-based. You got the functions, you got the technicality of the camera, physical camera itself, and you have the art, the creativity of how to capture a good photo, what makes a good photo in your eyes and someone else's eyes. So that's where they believe that digital camera has many possibilities. Photo ops. In the article they stated the children had many different types of photos they were taking. They asked them, they created an online photo journal, and as they were putting it together, the researchers asked the students, you know, what they saw and their reflections. And before we go into deeply in that, this is the type of photos they noticed they were taking. And this is my example of sneaking around the classroom the day before when we were doing our presentations and taking some snapshots. We have the object-focused or still images, which still means you take pictures of inanimate objects usually, and you give them like a lifelike personality to them. So here's me with my green water bottle, as everyone has probably noticed I carry it with me everywhere, and the hat that I used for our presentation the other day. And in the background you could see us working and getting involved, and I think our group was going on to present our cloud presentation. And then, of course, Dr. St. Pri's can of soda every day, and I noticed it was his Waste Watchers bottle. He would sip it, so I took notice of that, and I wanted to capture it. Then we have our portrait, which Petra took a photo of me in my wonderful getup, and then I took a photo of her in her sailor outfit. And that could be fun for kids. The kids really enjoy taking photos of their friends and, you know, telling what was going on. There's action. In this case, you know, I took it, I saw people were raising their hands, we were getting involved, but more so action. Maybe it could be more sports-like or running or something where they're moving around and you want to capture that feel. And then on the bottom, Dr. St. Pri again was looking at the group's presentation of the table of beer styles, so we were all getting a giggle out of that. We also have topic and theme. Topic for this one, they noticed they were taking a lot of photos of friends and giving stories about their friends, so I took a photo of my friend Amy watching the group's presentation on eclipses, a silhouette sort of. And then at my group table, Joel and Carrie, they were my new friends that I met this semester. When they were discussing the reflections and asking the students what they saw, and they didn't ask the questions, they just guided them to open up and talk about their photos. And what they found, the different approaches, I compared to Bloom's taxonomy of learning domains, and hopefully a lot of us are familiar with that. There were other classes, the different levels of thinking and knowledge and comprehension and all that. So the first was descriptive, the who. Here's an example of, I took this photo of a bee a few days ago while I was on a walk, and I'll go over this really quickly if you can read along, but descriptive. There is a bee on a wildflower. Very general, very, you know, basic. Explanatory. I took this photo because I like bees and wanted to put one up on my wall. I'm starting my collection of photos now on my walls, which I can't wait to finish. And then there's situative. I was walking down the street. And speaking of the journal, implications for classroom integration and learning, using the computer and internet, there is such a wealth of programs and software and online applications to incorporate and use in conjunction with other technologies using photos. The first one, image editing programs like Photoshop, PhotoStory. Here's one that I did for another class. We had to put together a video on one of our topics we were doing it to incorporate photos and stuff. So you take this and you could you use all different levels and layers, and you can get so creative, and it's so visual and so, you know, colorful, and people, you can have basically a field day on it doing it. Took me I don't know how long to make it, and it was so much fun. Then there's also photo organizing software where I'll put the photos in chronological order or by event order, such as iPhoto for the Mac, which is what I use. And then also a lot of the programs like that also come with applications to make calendars, to do greeting cards, and I find it very fun for the calendars. Our family, we used to do one every Christmas. We would take all our photos of the year, and well, actually I did it, and we put it together and I'd give it to them as a Christmas gift, and they loved it. So if you incorporate that in your classroom where you can take photos starting in September all the way to June and then come up with something, a portfolio or something in the end, it's really fun. And online photo albums and blogs, you can share them and have a lot of access online. There's Picasa, which is incorporated with Gmail, Flickr, which is Yahoo, or blogs. I actually started a blog Through the Lens about a year ago now, where I put my photos up that I take on a daily basis, and I share with family and friends who I don't see every day, and they just really enjoy being able to see what I see, and to, you know, it just, over again, it's just very visual, and it helps a lot of times when you, like, sometimes when you're speaking and you have a loss for words, you can show them a picture and it kind of comes back. You could describe and everything. Implications for social and cognitive development. Again, it's kind of like a scientific process, method. You take real life scenarios and you decide, well, what do I want to photograph and what can I get from this photograph? So you're observing, you're documenting, you're explaining. But you do have to have some considerations when you are using photography. For example, some cultures and ethnicities, they're not very take liking to taking photos of yourself or someone. So you have to be careful of that, you know, really get to know your students and their families, and if they don't like photos being taken of them, you know, respect that and work around that if possible. And also image use and rights. For classroom use, it's not going to really be a problem, but if you decide to post anything online, make sure for your own good you copyright it and put your name on it, because there's so many instances of people taking their photos, using it for, if it's a high resolution, using it for advertising purposes or just taking it. And it's flattering, but at the same time, it's your work and you want to be credited for it. So always just put your name on it, or the same token, if you use someone else's photos from online and you're using it in more than any type of just classroom activity, just credit whose photo it was. So if anything were to happen and they needed, you know, oh, you took my photo, well, I credited you in it, you know, just to be on the safe side. And lastly, child-friendly. Digital cameras are portable, but you want to not give a student the most complex camera of the sorts, because then it could get frustrating. It just keep it simple, let them explore, and as they develop their skills, you can bring it more into the classroom. And just for yourself, too, to just, you learn with the children, so if you open it up and really just make sure the children are getting out of it what they want. Don't control and say, well, you can only photograph this or photograph that. Let them grow and open up and figure it out for themselves. So I think just to sum it up with what I've discussed is the digital camera is definitely an explicit tool in discovering and exploring understandings of the self, others, and the classroom using a very social and cognitive reflecting approach.